You are listening to the Thrifty Living Podcast, episode number one. Today we are talking about money myths. So let's get started. Hello everybody, this is Susan. Welcome to the Thrifty Living Podcast. This is actually our very first podcast that we're recording, so bear with us if the volume and static is not exactly the way it needs to be. We will be working on that. We're trying to get our feet under us here a little bit. And the podcast is produced every week for your enjoyment, and the show notes can be found at thriftyliving.com. Come back often and feel free to add the podcast to your RSS feed or subscribe via iTunes. You can also find us on Pinterest, Twitter, as well as Facebook. All of these links can be found in the show notes below. So let's get into the topic for today. Anyone who has ever read very much or listened to podcasts about money and financial issues or read blogs on the topic has heard people say some very interesting things when it comes to the topic of money. People tend to have some interesting ideas about how money works for them, works against them. And so today we're going to just touch on the topic of myths about money. We're just going to hit five topics today and kind of get into what makes these myths, where these myths came from, and what the actual truth is. The first one we're going to hit today is that people who spend a lot of money have a lot of money. And I think we've all seen that, especially in our younger days. As we grow older, I think we kind of learn that what you see is not always reality. But when you're younger, in your teenage years, 20s, maybe even into your 30s, you see people who have big houses, they have new cars, they have the purses, the fancy shoes, you know, the BMWs. And you see these people in your everyday life and you think these are rich people. When in reality, most of those people are not. They don't have a lot of money. What they have is a lot of debt. And if you've ever read the book, The Millionaire Next Door, it's a very interesting book about what real millionaires look like, not what people think millionaires look like. They found in this book, they were looking for millionaires to interview, and they found, you know, they went to the high-class neighborhoods and the really ritzy places, and they found that that's not where they found their millionaires. They found that the people who lived in those ritzy neighborhoods and drove the fancy cars and ate at the most expensive restaurants, they didn't have a lot of money in their bank accounts. What they had was a lot of debt. So when they really got started digging into it, where they found their millionaires was just the normal, everyday little houses, you know, just next door to you, which is where they got their title, The Millionaire Next Door. These were the people who just lived normal lives, drove 7 to 10 year old cars, lived in your average 2-3 bedroom houses, nothing extravagant. They didn't stand out in their everyday lives. Most people didn't think they had two pennies to rub together. And these were the people who were sitting there with the $1 million in the bank. So a lot of times when it comes to money, the people who look like they don't have a lot outwardly may be the ones who have a lot. They're sitting on a lot in their bank account because they have their money going to places where it's actually working for them. Instead of blowing their money on things that people can see, they're putting their money in places where it is doing things for them, such as their 401k, such as their Roth IRA, such as putting it into investments. So that is myth number one. Now, our second myth is actually not something I've heard a whole lot, but I did hear this week, And it, I just shook my head when I heard this. And what it was if you buy items at thrift stores, such as the Goodwill or the Salvation Army, and you don't need to, what I mean by that is if you have the money to go to the mall, but you choose to go to the thrift store. So if you buy from the thrift stores when you don't need to, you are stealing from the poor people. I'm going to give you just a second for that to sink in, because it took me a little while for that to sink in. The person who said this seemed to believe that the only people who shopped at thrift stores, such as the Goodwill and Salvation Army or St. Vincent de Paul, were poor people who could not afford to go to the mall or to the boutiques to shop. There again, complete myth. First of all, it is not just poor people who shop at these kind of stores. You go back to number one, topic number, myth number one. Most of the time, the people who have money are the ones shopping at the places like this. Poor people are poor in some instances because they're blowing their money at the mall and the boutique. The person who said this seemed to not understand, or maybe they had never shopped at a thrift store. You know, if you are spending any time to amount to anything in a thrift store, you know that there is basically, I would say, three different people, you know, three different segments of people who shop at a thrift store. The first people who shop at a thrift store are going to be the people who really are limited on funds. They're really trying to stretch out their dollars and make it go as far as they possibly can. So they have enough sense to know that they can go to the thrift store and buy a pair of jeans for $5 rather than go to the mall and buy a pair for $50. So that is the segment number one that you're going to find at the thrift store. The second segment of people you're going to find at the thrift store are people who could go somewhere else and shop. They have the money to go somewhere else and shop, but they cannot mentally allow themselves to go and blow that type of money. I mean, for me to spend $50 on a pair of blue jeans, I would be terrified to put them on and wear them. That is just my personality, and it's the way that I've always been. Some people have no problem with that. That is what they love. They love their designer jeans, and that's fine. You know, people are different. That's fine. It's not that one way is right and one way is wrong, but that's just my personality. And thirdly, the people that you will find at the thrift store are resellers. There is a huge profit to be made shopping at a thrift store. Just taking other people's, what they consider to be trash, or, you know, taking that items from the waste stream, from being just thrown away, and saving those items and representing them to another segment of the population that's looking for them. You know, what is available in one area of the country is not available a lot of, you know, in the other area of the country. So to take those items and recycle them, save them from being thrown in the garbage, you're not only making yourself a tidy little profit, you know, it can be a really profitable little side hustle, and it is something that I do on the side and love to do, to dig through a box of, you know, junk at a yard sale and pull out something I can make $30 or $40 on. You know, it just thrills me. So those are the three segments of people you're going to find at a thrift store. The actual people who don't have the money to shop somewhere else, the people who cannot mentally allow themselves to shop somewhere else, and the people who are looking to make money. So it is not just the poor people who shop at the thrift stores. Okie dokie, number three on our myths about money, we have you need debt to get good credit. Now, I do understand where this myth was born, because myself, I had never had any debt up until a few years ago. And we started toying with the idea of buying a different house, and found out very quickly that we had a zero credit score. And that was because we had never borrowed money. We just did not believe in going into debt for things. So I did at that time. I got my first two credit cards and started using them. Now, having said that, I did not use those credit cards to create debt. I was not interested in creating debt. This is the thing about finances. You just have to think about what you're doing. I was interested in creating a FICO score. And there is some truth to the saying that you have to have some debt, or you have to have paid debts to create a FICO score. But you don't need to create the debt, I should say. You just need to use the debts that you already have. And by that, what I mean is, I do use my credit card all the time. I use it every month. I run it up every month. Then I pay it off every month. But the things that I use my credit card on are the things that I would be having to pay for anyway. Things such as my electric bill, my AT&T, my cell phone bill, my groceries. When I go to the grocery store, I put those on my credit card. And let's see, my water bill goes on the credit card. And the thing is, at the end of the month, you can actually go into, which is real handy about this online banking, you can go into your account and you can set your online banking account up to automatically pay your balance in full. The problem that a lot of people have with a credit card and how they run up massive amounts of debt is that it is so easy to swipe that thing and not have to have the money. It is so easy when you get a bill at the end of the month for $800 and it says, well, you only have to pay $20. It is so easy to pay that $20. But if you are being responsible with your money, that is not what you need to do. You have to get in the habit of paying it off each and every month and not carrying a balance. Carrying debt is not a bad thing. Credit cards are not a bad thing, but carrying a balance on them is a bad thing. Okay, myth number 4. We are at, life is boring if you're saving all your money. Okay, I hear this all the time. If you are trying to pinch every penny, when do you ever get to have fun? The problem with this idea is that the people who believe this, they honestly believe that in order to have fun in your day-to-day life, you have to be spending money. Money does not equal fun. Fun is what you make of it. You can have tons and tons of fun and do all sorts of creative, interesting, educational things with your family without blowing a ton of money. So many people, especially with teenagers, they believe that the only way to have a good time, the only way to spend a Friday, Saturday night, oh, let's go out to dinner at a fancy restaurant, let's go to the movies, let's go to the mall and shop, shop, shop. That may be fun for a lot of people. That's great, but that is not the only way to have a good time with your family. There are many, many things that you can do that are free or very inexpensive that can be a lot of fun for yourself and for your family. My family, one of the things that we really enjoy doing, we like to go to the mall. We go to the mall probably twice a month, but when we go, we don't go with the idea that we're going to spend a ton of money. We're going to shop, shop, shop. Oh, I need a new outfit. Oh, I need a new purse. That's not what we do. We go to the mall to get out of the house. We really enjoy watching the people. I don't know why, but my whole family kind of enjoys people watching. We normally do eat there. We'll eat at the food court because my daughter is a vegan. She's a little bit hard to please. So it helps when we're eating somewhere like that, that we can all kind of get what we want. So a lot of times, you know, we will eat there. We're going to have to eat anyway. So that is our big splurge, is actually eating at the food court. We'll walk around. We could spend hours and hours at the mall just walking, looking at people, checking stuff out. You know, you can see what the coolest new fashion is and then look for it when you go to the thrift store. Nothing wrong with that. We do tend to, when we go to the mall, we tend to make our thrift store rounds. We hit the Value Village. We hit the Goodwill. Am I going to buy something every time I walk in there? No. Just because you walk in a store doesn't mean you have to spend money. You can, what I call prowl, you can prowl around for hours and not spend anything. Another thing that you can do is, and my family really enjoys doing, is going to national parks. We like to go on short hikes. I'm not the most in shape person, my husband either, but we do like to get out in nature if the weather, you know, is good. In Georgia, you don't want to go when it's 105 degrees, but especially this time of year in October, it is awesome for going outside and just checking out nature. And most of those places, you're spending $3 to park. That is what it's costing you to go. Another thing that you can do is, my daughter and myself, we both love to read. We could go to Books A Million and buy tons of books. But why would we do that when we have a local library who has an awesome librarian? We can go get what we want. If they don't have it, she'll get it for us and then call us when it comes in. You can also check out DVDs. You can look at magazines so you don't have to subscribe to those magazines. Save you a ton of money on subscription fees. Let's see, other things that you can do. We have in my area, we have another local park that has it's like a fountain for kids for the summertime. It costs $2 to get into it. Yes, I pay $2 to go to the fountain versus putting a pool in your backyard, you know, for $15,000. You just have to give it some thought as to what you're doing. Go outside, take a walk, play hide and seek. Play ping pong. Something that my family's always kind of like to do, and this is probably going to sound crazy, but we like to go to the Home Depot or Lowe's and walk around. You can just walk around and dream about the things you'd like to do in your house, because we love, you know, we like to do DIY projects, and I'm sure you can go camping, you can go fishing. You can cook for your family if you like to cook. I mean, all of these are ways that you can spend a great time with your family. Take your kids into your kitchen and make cookies, make a cake. You know, all those ingredients are not very expensive, but your children will remember those for years and years. Make homemade ice cream, and you can do that in the summertime and the wintertime. You know, if you get snow, make snow ice cream. Let's see, maybe you can change a room in your house. You know, paint your, you know, a room in your house. That's pretty cheap. A gallon of paint is pretty cheap. Make homemade pizza instead of going out. Do puzzles. You know, there's so many things that you can do with your family that do not require a lot of money. I mean, that are even free or very inexpensive. And the very last thing on my list today, myth number 5, and one of my favorites, is I can't save money because I don't make very much money at my job. I understand this. We've all been there. Some of us may still be there at a place in our life where we're just not making as much money as we want or need in our day job. Now, myself, in my day job, I am a school teacher. Love my job. Love what I do. Love my kids. Do I love the paycheck? Not so much. If you have any teachers or are a teacher, if you have any teachers in your family, you know, we don't really make that much. You know, that's not why we get into that job anyway, right? But I make much more than I used to when I worked at the daycare. You know, when I was straight out of high school, I think minimum wage, I think, was $5.25 then. Yes, I'm showing my age, so I do make more than that now, but I certainly, you know, do you ever make enough? That's the question. So it's not about how much you make. It is about how much you keep. And there, the only limit to your income is your imagination. And what I mean by that is just because you don't make a whole lot at your day job doesn't mean that has to be where your income stops. I have my day job that I go to, and then I have a list of things that I do on the side. And in the financial world, I have come to find that they are called side hustles. I had never thought of them as a side hustle. I just always thought I'm always doing more than one thing. You know, there have been times my husband would tell people I had four jobs, but it doesn't feel like four jobs because, you know, maybe only one of them is a job, a day job. The rest of them are hustles or gigs or side things. So right now, the things that I do are my day job, which is teaching, and then on the side, I do some tutoring. I do a pretty good business on eBay, reselling things around my house and things that I picked up at thrift stores and yard sales. I do the blog, and now I'm adding into that this podcast, which the blog and the podcast do not really create very much money. That's not the purpose in doing these, but there is a little bit, you know, there's some pennies that I don't knock the pennies because that is the whole premise of our blog. We save the pennies because the pennies equal dollars and the dollars equal freedom. I like the freedom. So I do save the pennies. Like I said before, the only limit to your income is your imagination. I totally forgot one of my other side hustles. Occasionally, when they need me, I will drive a school bus in the afternoon. I used to drive the bus when I was going to college working on my degree. That was my job, my day job. So I still have my CDL license, and of course I still know everybody there. So when they get stuck and they really don't have anybody to drive in the afternoon, you know, they'll give me a call on my cell phone and they'll load the bus up for me, and then I'll take the kids home. I'm trying to think of some more stuff that I do. Okay, I do swag bucks, and that's just a really easy like an add-on that you can add to your computer, and you do your searches through it rather than through Google or Bing or another search engine. You can also do surveys online. There's not a lot of money there, but, you know, there's pennies. It just depends on what, you know, if you're laying in bed at night doing a few surveys before you go to bed, you know, it's taking you 5 minutes and you're making 50 cents. That's pretty good money spent. You know, you add that up, you're making pretty good hourly pay there. If you spent any time on my blog, you know that, my eBay selling is pretty, I have an eBay store. And I usually average about 500 to 600 items in my store at any given time. I do have a spare bedroom in my house that is kind of my storage place where I have all my inventory stored. That was also something I did as well when I was in college that helped to allow me to graduate debt-free. I didn't have to take out any college loans. I had my eBay. I always call it my eBay money. I had all that to help pay my books. And goodness knows those can be expensive. Another side hustle you can do, you can, you know,